see a lot of familiar faces. Who was at Prototype Con a couple months ago? 1, 2, 3, 4. Just see some familiar faces from there.
Yeah.
Twist here. James, you were here. Seth was there too.
That's true. Yeah. You want to introduce yourself? We'll go down the line. So
yeah, let's go.
They
right
should
to
listen
left,
to us, or probably more advice.
My name is Mike Pascal. I'm the purchasing manager for Peach State Hobby Distribution here in Longwood, Florida. We have 5 locations across the country, and we have a sister company, Koki Hobby Distribution, with a location in Sao Paulo, Brazil.
I'm Seth Greer. I'm VP of Quartermaster Logistics. We do crowdfunding, fulfillment, warehousing, shipping, all the fun logistical parts of getting stuff to your backers.
I'm James Hudson with Drew City Games, and I've made all the mistakes in the last year, and I'm here to tell you all things not to do.
I think you've done a couple things right, though, James.
It's like Timmy and Toolman Taylor. Everybody saw that show back in the day. That's what I'm here for. So cool. I know that this is mostly supposed to be a Q&A from you guys, so we have a mic that can be floated around, and you can ask your questions, and you've got 3 different sectors of the market here that can help answer your questions. So.
Before we get some, do we have any questions? You want to kind of describe what we do in a little more detail?
Sure.
So they kind of get a little more focused
sure.
on what the different skills are.
And with that, you can start.
Okay. So, who here knows what distribution does? A little less than half, okay. So, distribution, we vet games, any games you may design, any big publishers design, and we purchase those products and we keep them in our different warehouses across the country in high volume. We wholesale only to resellers across the country. That's brick and mortar stores, that's online stores, that's anybody who's got a resale so we can sell products so that different publishers have different restrictions. Our main goal is to handle logistics of product, making sure that it costs a lot of money to ship, well, you know for sure, you know as well, it costs a lot of money in shipping and freight. If you're shipping 1 or 2 copies of a game to somebody, you're gonna pay out the wazoo. If you just sell me 1,000 copies of your game, I'm then gonna sell it to, you know, 700-800 stores across the country, and we're gonna network and distribute your products in a much wider net that you would not be able to do on your own, most likely. So that's what distribution does. We handle the logistics of your products. We handle marketing and advertising to retailers. And it's better we don't touch the end consumer market. That is still something that if you're designing a game and you want to be the publisher, you need to be responsible for. We do help you with that. We do offer advice, but we handle the logistics of everything once it hits our warehouses.
And it's also a service to the retailers too, because it helps them be able to make orders that are grouped together.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
Well, you gotta think, I mean, on a monthly basis, I'm in contact with about 180 to 200 different publishers or purchasing sources across the world. You times that, every single retailer now having to contact those sources they wanna do, it's an impossible task, not just for the retailers, but also for the manufacturers and the publishers to be able to handle that much influx of information or influx of questions about their products. So it makes it a lot easier for retailers to get the products from us, or further stores, I should say.
It consolidates everything into one location.
Correct.
You're not having to contact 200, 300 plus people.
Yeah. Manage the logistics.
Yeah.
Nice. Let the pitch go.
Yeah. So, Quartermaster Logistics, I mean, if you're doing a crowdfunding campaign, you have a game, you have an idea for a game that you want to put out there, you put your blood, sweat, and tears into it, you've come up with how much it's going to cost to manufacture this thing, to get it out there, and then there's the part where you actually have to deliver that to your audience, to your backers who support you. And we're there to help you get clarity on that and to help you actually do that. If you're not researching the costs of fulfillment ahead of time, you're doing yourself a big disservice. You're just basically setting up yourself for a world of hurt. I mean, James might have a good guess as to the percentage of his campaign that was towards that, but I mean, it can be upwards of 20-30% of the overall costs of your campaign going to just getting your goods to your backers alone. So basically, we help you guys figure all that out, whether it's, you know, doing a single stream for the US, or if you're going worldwide and you're doing multiple streams to the US, to the EU, whether you want to do customs friendly or not, how you deal with customs and paying that up front or letting your backers pay for that. There are tons and tons, hundreds of questions to be answered, to go through, to make sure you have all your ducks in a row so that you're doing your best to help out your backers and make sure the product gets there in a timely and hopefully cost-efficient manner.
So how would you, what timeline would you give a creator? When should they reach out to you and start getting quotes and getting ideas? Because I'm sure you've never got an email from someone that says, hey, our games are coming over from China next week and we need to fill around the world. Can you help?
They're on a boat right now. Can you help?
Yeah, that's never
happened. Never happens.
No. I mean, the earlier you can start, the better. I mean, especially you could get a couple months lead on when you're launching your campaign so you can build those costs into your campaign. Hopefully you have some type of prototype out there so we can get a guesstimate of what it's gonna weigh, what the size and dimensions are gonna be. If you have any idea of what your audience might be, so the number of copies you're looking to print, those are all kind of important pieces of information that we need to know to help you. But you definitely wanna get that out before you're even launching your campaign.
For sure, and you can reach out to your manufacturer and ask them for estimations on weight and size, and they can give that to you. Because if you've already given their component list of what they're going to need to make for the game, they can generally get you really, really close. It won't be exact, but then you can give that information set, and he can give you accurate estimations on your shipping costs.
So with the weight, that reminded me of something. Make sure if you change anything after you get your freight quotes, if you add 10 cards, 15 cards, it could be the smallest thing going from 7.9 pounds to 8 pounds, you're going to pay a significant difference. So if you do change anything, get a requote on your freight from your fulfillment, because it can kill you. I mean, completely destroy any profit and any money you're having coming in from any other source. You're going to have to pay out the wazoo.
Yeah, you got to, with that too, when you have your stretch goals that you're planning that you would like to add to your game, those typically add weight or different ramifications to your box size. Like in my case for Grim Forest, we added 5 miniatures. Well, our box size doubled. And so I was having to go back, and I'd already planned for that a little bit because we assumed we would hit those goals, and we wanted to kind of have worst case scenario in case we did hit those goals. For shipping, not for us, is the worst case. But you know, you've got to plan all those things out, because if you don't, exactly what Mike said, is you're going to get hit with, oh, I didn't know this was going to be 3 times what I originally planned for the shipping to be. And then all the money that you thought you had left over is now in the wind.
Yeah, I'll give you some exact numbers. I was working with a guy, a very strong product, fantastic game, and it's completely DOA now. Because he messed this up, the box was 7.85 pounds. He added like a deck of cards and some components, and it went to 8.1. It took the price for the fulfillment freight from $2.50 to almost $10 a copy. That was a huge chunk. And he was so far along, he collected money from backers and everything, there's no way he could have recouped that, and it completely tanked any profit he was making on the Kickstarter. And then that whole thing, he's still to this day paying for it out of pocket almost 2 years later. So be mindful of freight. That is a killer. It can sneak up on you.
And
that's where Seth can help you out. Be in touch with the fulfillment companies you're using to keep you in line with what you know you're going to
cost. This is the unfun part, right? Like, you guys are all creators. You've got your game idea. You're excited to get your game in front of people. You only want to build games. This is the business side. This is the part that if you don't do well, you will only do this once, because it will ruin you. You'll bankrupt yourself, and you'll never be able, especially reputation-wise on Kickstarter, if you don't deliver what you say you're going to, no one's going to back you ever again.
Yeah.
And so if you want to be able to do the fun stuff, you got to trudge through the business side. And yeah. I know if you're like me, it's not exciting at all, but it has to be done.
Yeah, and kind of going back to what you were saying about like planning those stretch goals out, I mean, it can be something where you're thinking, oh man, this would be such a cool thing to be able to include, like, we want to do a playmat with this, and something seemingly insignificant, or maybe it's not even that bad to print that up or have that made, can significantly impact your shipping costs. So really planning those things ahead and doing them smartly so that they're all combined in the same box, you're not having to deal with multiple picks. And as those things develop over the course of your campaign, keep going back and getting those requotes. You know, how's this gonna affect me in my bottom line for this?
So on my end, I'm marketing and advertising is the field that I came out of, and that's what I just left to come be a publisher in this publishing world. So one of the biggest things that you need to understand about Kickstarter or Indiegogo or whatever platform you decide to use is you have to bring the audience to the page. Just because there's 35 million, 40 million people that go to Kickstarter every month does not mean they're going to find your page for your game. It is one of the fastest growing verticals in Kickstarter, but that doesn't, again, does not mean anything to you specifically. So you have to build an audience. I know that seems daunting, but it's what must, it's, again, it's another one of those necessary things that have to be done. And you can't do that by just going and spamming three or four Facebook groups before you launch. You need to do a lot of pre-marketing. So pre-marketing, what is that? That is, you're building your company out. You're showing part of your, you're sharing your story. What are you building? What world are you making? What type of game are you making? You're putting it out there. You're adding people to your newsletter base. That is one of the best conversion rates that you can have in your pipeline. People that are really following your company and are behind what you're doing. You need to come to all these conventions. You need to play your game in front of people. You need to let the public see it. You need to get organic people out there talking about your game because it was fun. So here's the hard part. Here's the harsh part. It's very harsh. If you're doing those things and no one is responding, you might not have a good idea. It's not, that's not a reality that a lot of us want to hear. As someone who's designed a few games myself, guess what? Some of them have not got any response. And I was like, man, why is no one in this game? I love it. Personally, this is great. And when, you know, 100 people play it and only 10 say they like it, or you can tell, guys, you can tell when somebody is giving you that, oh yeah, you look great in that dress. Right? You can tell organically when you step back from the table and watch people play if they're organically having a good time. If they're not, you need to reassess what the fun factor is in your game, because we at our core are selling fun. This is a luxury hobby. People do not have to spend money on board games. So if we don't sell fun, then I don't know what we're doing.
Right. Okay?
So in that, it all kind of pulls into there, right? From there, you can generate organic engagement. People who will share your campaign without you bribing them. Now, I'm not against bribing. Let me just be on record. You can do giveaways. You can do all the things that are going to help people be motivated to share your project. But you should see some on its own, right? If you're not seeing any, you might need to reassess, or you might need to seek out help. We've got Daniel Zayas here in the audience. He is an actual Kickstarter expert. He had to go through a process through Kickstarter. He does a consulting marketing situation where he helps people on that side of things, because more than likely, you're a game creator that has a game created idea. You're not a marketer. So it's really hard to wear every hat as a small publisher. You know, be a project manager, a designer, a creator, a playtester, a business acumen for all the bookkeeping. I'll raise my hand and say that's where I completely failed. And I went and got help. You have to pay people, right? You probably can't do all the art yourself. You probably can't do all the graphic design yourself. You're going to need to find key areas that you're weak at and hire good people into those areas.
That's what you did. You did it very well, getting the Eisner Brothers.
It's because I'm not good at a lot. So that was easy.
Yeah, you got the right people. You're working with definitely some of the right people, for sure.
Yeah, and don't be, and I've kind of given this this motivational Tony Robbins speech before, but it's going to cost you money, like real money, not $500. It's going to cost you a substantial amount of money in today's Kickstarter market to bring a game to market that will get attention. The CMONs of the world have set the standard. We have to bring a completed game. You, no longer the days, I know we're all altruistic and we want, some of us want, you know, Kickstarter to be this thing where we can bring it to the masses and I wrote it on a napkin, here's my idea, help me fund it. That's just not, I'm gonna go Gary Vee on you guys for a second, if you guys follow any Gary Vee. The market doesn't give a damn about your feelings. And you've only got what they will do for you. And so if you don't bring it to them that they want, then you're not gonna get anywhere. So you can hem and haw all day about this is the way it should be, or you can get to work in the way it is. And so I want to definitely say I see that from the spotlight group the most when creators reach out to me and say, will you give me some feedback on my page? They don't really want feedback. They want me to reaffirm what they've already done. And so when I give them feedback, they, you know, immediately start debating me on what I said. Well, why'd you ask? Why'd you ask me? If you didn't want my real feedback. I want your real feedback. If something's bad, I want to hear it so that I can go, okay, how do I change that? Or, you know, if you ask 10 people and 9 kind of give you the same feedback, there's something to it. Maybe if it's just 1 out of 10, you can ignore it.
Yeah, what does that tell you? If you're the only one, if everyone around you is wrong, you can't be right. That's it. You cannot be right.
Okay, I think we probably, yeah, questions. Who's got it? Got a mic, let's go around.
I don't know how involved this question, letter, and things putting together in my head. Depending on the size of the game and all the things that you want to fulfill in the project, is it better when you have a smaller game to go with something like a crowdfunder where you don't have to hit a certain mark for it to be funded completely versus something that's more involved, like a large board game, go with something like Kickstarter versus like a GoFundMe page?
So I'm not going to tell you what to do with your life. I'm not your boss. But if you don't go to Kickstarter, if you go to any other platform, you're going to fail. The market for board games, if you're making a board game, maybe you're making something, an accessory or something different. That's different. But if we're talking about just games, Kickstarter is where the market is at. Other publishers have tried to go to Indiegogo, and Indiegogo's even putting efforts behind that. And as they should, there's a big, obviously we're in the revolution of board games. But right now, it would be ill-advised for me to give you advice to go anywhere except Kickstarter. That's where people are networking for board games, that's where people go for board games. So,
yeah, without a doubt. Same thing on the retail side. I think if you go that far, if you have an Indiegogo or a GoFundMe page, it's not going to be taken as seriously as a Kickstarter page, without a doubt. It's just your exposure and the accessibility to the end consumer and the retailer is just so much more comfortable with them using a Kickstarter page as opposed to Indiegogo or GoFundMe, that it's a better market. I mean, that's what Kickstarter, Jake was kind of touching. Kickstarter is no longer the place to go to fund your project and get your dream made. It's a pre-order site and it's a marketing tool. That's all it is anymore at this stage. I do not view it in any other capacity.
And the big problem with Indiegogo is the end consumer is not comfortable with it because they want to see that you have to hit the mark that you set for your goal, that you can produce the product. And if you don't get that amount of money, are they just throwing their money away?
Yeah.
That's the, you know, at least with Kickstarter, you know, if you say you need $10,000 to make a minimum run of a product, if they don't hit it, then they don't lose their money.
Yeah, it's more of the comfort level of people spending their money. They understand what you're doing comparative to other products they've backed before. What it's doing, how it's trending, what to expect from it. It's a comfort level, and people are giving you money 4 to 6 months in advance for something they're not gonna see for a while.
And that was the number one reason. I interviewed Luke Crane, he's the head of board games at Kickstarter, and that's exactly what he said. That was their number one feather in the hat. That was the biggest difference between them and Indiegogo for that comfort level for the end consumer. They wanna have that one plus blanket.
I think I've backed about 75 or 80 board games on Kickstarter. So I've never tried to run a campaign. But can you folks explain why so many people are so bad at understanding all the things that might happen? So they don't promise a date and then they're 6 months to a year later because they say, oh, we didn't expect it to be this tough. We didn't realize, we forgot about the holiday in China and stuff. Why are people at this point still seemingly clueless about planning ahead for things that it's obvious that people run into all the time?
That's easy.
So you kind of answered it. Well, they don't know. That's the thing. You just said the one thing that a lot of people don't even
consider is the holidays that, that China has. They go on holiday for a whole month. And it's not just like they go on a holiday for a month and come back. Usually what happens is they go on holiday, they go back home where the family needs them there, so they stay. A large portion of the workers wind up staying home. So now the factories have to rehire a whole bunch of new people, retrain them, get the speed. So they're closed for a month, but their production level didn't stop for a month. Their production level stopped for effectively 6 to 8, maybe even more weeks beyond that, getting everybody trained up, getting high damages. So if you're producing a product that's gonna be launching right after China, or after Chinese holiday, there's a good chance you may have an error, you may have some issues with your product. Well, so that's another thing people need to time their products with. Don't make it so your stuff's getting made right after the holidays. But to your question, they don't know. There's a million questions to ask, and there is not a single good source. There's a bunch of different sources all over the internet, but there is not a one-stop place to go to find the information. I think Jamie Stagmeier's blog and James Mathey's blogs are probably the most condensed bits of information you can get. James Mathey, M-A-T-H-E, and Jamie Stagmeier of Stonemeyer Games. But even then, there's still a whole bunch of other little granular questions in there that you may have or things that may arise. So it's a big problem to figure out. And infrastructure-wise, as an industry, we're very small. And we're not, most people have been in this hobby, even the larger publishers, got into the business because it's a hobby, because it's a passion. And to a lot of degrees, even the bigger guys are still trying to figure things out and things are falling through the cracks. So there's not a good,
it's a lot,
resource tool in a single consumable spot.
It's a lot. That's one. It's hard. You're passionate about making games and not necessarily, it's my least favorite part, right? Figuring out fulfillment. This is a lot. So it's not malicious. 99.9% of the time. It's not malicious.
It's a whoops. Purpose. Yeah.
It sucks because they now have your money, but it's all it is. It's just a whoops.
But you know, and as an end consumer, that's what Kickstarter is. You're taking a chance on someone who's already raised their hand to say that we don't know what we're doing in all areas, but we have a passion to make this product. And so, we could rail negatively on that question all day, but that's kind of the,
Yeah, I see on Kickstarter games that have, say, Europe-friendly shipping, Canada-friendly shipping, and who do we go to talk about to get that to happen?
Seth. Okay. I'd like to introduce you to Seth, International Logistics.
So for those of you who don't know what EU or Canada-friendly means, that means that it's friendly to those locations in order it's customs-friendly, so that your backers aren't having to pay the customs on their game being sent to them. And typically that process happens by sending a large shipment to fulfillment centers in those areas. So you would send it to a local European fulfillment center or a Canadian fulfillment center, and you as the creator are paying those customs, those VAT taxes up front on behalf of your consumer. And so there's, we're networked with some companies in Europe, in Canada, in China, and in Australia to get, friendly shipping in all those areas. So, we're one company you can talk to. There are others. Yeah, I know Jamie Stegmeier has a blog, and even I think it's like a Google Doc that has a bunch of those companies as well. If you want to go there to look and see what the different ones are. You can go to them individually. There are some companies like us who do all the coordinating on your behalf, which is a task in and of itself. but those are basically your options. So you're looking at companies like GamesQuest in the United Kingdom, or Snakes and Lattes up in Canada, Aetherworks in Australia. Companies like that are the ones who are the ones doing that kind of.
Yeah, because if you don't take care of that beforehand, then your backer, what happens is they have to go to their customs office and pick up your package with your game and pay the tax themselves. So, yeah, that's not, you won't get more backers that way ever again. So,
You have to take care of it for them on the front end by prepaying and value-added tax. There's tax systems there. And what's even more confusing and why you need a liaison is each one of the countries in the EU have a different setup. And so you've got to be able to finagle all of that. So it makes it tough.
What about through some other companies? I'll throw out GameCrafter or DriveThruRPG with their print and play models.
Yeah, you can do that, but you're only ever going to be a boutique game maker there because their cost to make a game is
very high.
20 times as much as what you can get a game made in China at mass. So if you're, there's nothing wrong with that. Like if you've got an idea and you want to put it there, that's great. But if you have aspirations of actually being a publisher and getting out mass market wide, that's not an option.
Yeah. You will not be able to produce it at an effective cost, nor will you be able to produce the volume needed for, let's say you go through a bit successful, you go through distribution, you'll never be able to produce the volume that I'll need.
So there's a question right here,
right behind you.
I just wanted, I did back Brick Force.
Why would you do that? It's terrible.
Shut up, Mike.
But so one of my friends had a campaign and fully funded and everything. But one of their production companies pretty much said, we can't do it, and backed out. Basically, the numbers that they needed to make was too much. And so do you think it's worthwhile to set up like backups? Or is that something that you should more react to as opposed to paying money up front to other companies?
Was that for the manufacturer or the shipping?
The manufacturer.
Sure. Yeah. On your end, you should already have multiple quotes and multiple manufacturers.
Get everybody up, get close with everyone.
So it doesn't, you're not sure which one you're gonna go with, or you will eventually pick who you wanna go with, but if that happened, then you could just go to one of your other quotes and reach out and say, hey, I need to spool this up.
If they had already started producing, and then they said, sorry, we can't do this many.
The joys of working with China.
Right.
They just do that.
Well, and I'll back that up and I'll say, I bet they didn't ask about their maximum capacities. So again, on your end, it still goes back to you to say, hey, if I need 15,000 copies of this game, is that within your capability? Now, there'll be some situations where you're lied to and they say they can do something they can't, but that's not the norm. Like what you're saying, that's not typical, but if you don't ask a lot of questions, their setup and the way that they do business is much different than here in America. So you need to, it's okay to ask even more questions than you normally would.
And that kind of touches on what this gentleman asked. They just probably didn't ask the question because they didn't know.
You assume.
There's a lot of things. So that's
more money.
I was working with this one Kickstarter game, and he sent me one of the samples he got in from the manufacturer, and I'm looking through the cards, and the same card had different saturation colors on it. And he didn't even, you would have never thought either. You send them the color files, print this. But he had to pay extra for color saturation matching on the printing. So we got all these copies of the games and they were starting to print them. And we just like, oh my God, these cards are completely different colors. Like it was green and then light green. So that's something you would have never thought to ask, is color saturation matching. And then they don't care. They just don't care. They won't do that quality check for you. That's the thing about these manufacturers. They will not do the quality check for you.
Now, there are some really good quality manufacturers, but you might get a quote from someone you've never heard of, and you're like, I'm going to get that. I found a better deal. It might be your reason you found a better deal.
Yeah.
Question on the side?
Okay, so I see some Kickstarters, and they have, say, a price that you pay just up ahead of time, and it includes your shipping, and then I see other Kickstarters that have shipping will be charged after. How does that work? Is that, again, with a fulfillment company? Or because, I mean, if you don't know exactly what it's going to be, just charging the shipping after sounds really smart.
So let me ask you a question. How many Kickstarters have you backed?
Just one so far.
Just one, okay. Who here has backed a bunch of Kickstarters? All right, do you like for your shipping to be included so you, when your pledge goes out, it goes one time, or do you like to have to pay money twice? Raise your hand if you like to have to pay money twice.
Like to or mind doing it?
Well, even if you mind, do you mind?
Yeah, see, it's so the market doesn't like that, right? So you can do it that way, and people do, and they do it successfully, right? But typically, they've made a product that people will do anything to have. Like CMON, if they make their games, people are going to get it. It doesn't matter if they pay for shipping later. You being someone we don't know, you need to make it easy for people to buy your product. You've got to make the journey along the path as easy and as engaging as you can. And that would be one that would turn people away. Whether it's right, wrong, or indifferent, doesn't matter. It's going to turn some people away. And you won't turn anybody away with it being included. Does that make sense?
Okay. Thank you.
Crowdfunding forum. What's the benefit financially, character-wise, doing crowdfunding versus signing with a mega conglomerate like Asmodee?
Ooh, my favorite. Okay, so I'm going to encourage everyone in this room who wants to do a Kickstarter to take your game to speed dating and pitch to a publisher. But I want to make my own company. Do it anyway. Because what you're going to get is a ton of feedback for why they can't take it to market. That's good information for you, right? Why they can't fit it in their pipeline. What struggles they may have manufacturing. They're not going to give you like a bullet point type situation, but when you hear things like, man, that would be really hard to manufacture at mass production with whatever materials that you're showing them. Or, hey, that theme doesn't fit any market that we have. Your return question is, what is your audience? So now you're aligning what the theme is that you want to make your game to audiences. So now you know who you need to pitch it to for your, if you do want to go to it. Or you might say, man, all the things that Mike, Seth, and James talked about, I don't want to do any of that. I just want to make games. Then you're a designer, and you should take your designs and just pitch them and not really flood yourself under the tidal wave tsunami that is trying to run your own company.
Yep. Yeah, if you don't want to work really, really, really hard to sell your game to somebody. Because it's a lot of work, it's a lot of hours, it's a lot of pulling your hair out to make sure that everything getting from the manufacturer to the end consumer is going to work.
Mike, how many new games come across your face to add to your catalog in a month?
In a month, so about 100 new items a week. That's on a light week.
So 400 new items a month come across Mike's face to add to his catalog, that so you can get into distribution, right? How do people stand out in those? And that's mixed in with people that you're already doing business with.
That's isn't that the golden question? How do they stand out? Man, there's no good single answer. It just has to be a good product. Has to be great marketing, has to have great in-consumer awareness and marketing. You have to be going to shows. You have to have, preferably, I'd like to have people having more than one product for us to carry you. It's market exposure. That's one of the biggest things. There's a lot of fantastic games. I don't think he's in the audience here. He's a local guy, Corey Guff, made a game called 7-7. Awesome game, fantastic game. I've known about it for a couple of years, and I'd love to carry it, but he won't sign it to a publisher, and I know he's not gonna go to the shows that I need him to actually get it out there to people. So market exposure is the number one thing. If you're not out there pushing your game, promoting your product, as good as it is, as fantastic as the game is, unfortunately, I'm gonna pass on it. Because we sell to retailers, and retailers react to end consumers, and end consumers react to what you are telling them.
It's hard.
Yeah.
All right. So based on that combination of information about finding a publisher and about the distribution, would that be a great factor for you determining which games to add to your distribution center? Would be whether or not they come from a publisher versus how much of a difference would that make?
It's a perk. It's definitely a plus. How much on like at a graded scale? I don't know. I mean, I do work with some just Kickstarter designers themselves directly, but it helps. It helps a lot.
PhD more than most, so you're getting the good end of the scale here. Most won't even really take you serious until you've got three or four games in your catalog that you can show them.
Yeah.
So Mike's kind of the exception there. He will actually talk to you and assess your product a little bit.
Yeah. And how many like 4 a.m. Facebook conversations have we had back and forth?
Yeah, Mike helped me out a lot with like, that's a stupid idea, don't do that.
So
So it helps, but it's not a roadblock if you are on your own and you're not with a publisher. It does make it easier for getting into the catalog because think about restocks, right? If I just need to get 6 copies in a warehouse and that's all I need to keep there for a month, that's all I'm gonna wanna get there. So if I work with a publisher where I'm ordering from, you know, 20 or 30 different titles and I've got large shipments coming in of all those, I can just throw on the 6 copies that I need. But if you're working by yourself and you have like $1,000 freight allowance, I'm gonna wait until I get to $1,000. And if you only have one title, it's gonna take me a while to get to the point where if I even do it all, order $1,000 worth of that game for one of our warehouses, because they perform differently than the other ones. A good example, our New Jersey location. I order 30% more of a title if it's Cthulhu-based, because for some reason in the Northeast, they really like Cthulhu games. If it's in Texas, and it's a military game, I order 30% more there.
So one thing I often ask panelists when they talk about this, and you kind of brought it up with companies, a lot of people talk about not dealing directly with the factories and going through some intermediate people. I mean, the name Panda comes up in What's Games and stuff. Would you recommend doing that as opposed to trying to make your own deals with factories? Because these other companies seem to be taking care of the quality. They claim at least wise, they'll do the quality checks for you, and so you don't end up with a bunch of stuff shipped to you that's not color corrected and junk like that.
Yeah, sure, there's a definite advantage to using that, especially if a company has a US liaison that kind of is your account rep. You're gonna have less communication errors and things like that. You're gonna be paying a premium though. That's just, right, they've gotta pay all the people in the middle. And so if you can work it out yourself, you can save some money. I used a unknown company at the time, Bing Wu, Bang Wei was the name of the company, and Bing was my account rep. He did a great job for us, and we took a chance on that because Bark Out Roundup, our first campaign, did $17,000, and so it got overfunding, but it didn't like smash it out where we had tons of room and lots of leeway. And so for us to make the minimum run that we wanted to make and get the margins, we went with him. And he did a great job for us, but it was a little risky because what the games that I saw that he had made some games, but he didn't have a huge catalog of games. So, you know, that would be the first thing. Just like you would if you were checking anything else, like if somebody was gonna come install something at your house, you'd ask somebody for some sort of reference. So just ask people for references. Look at the games. If they're a game that you've played before that you can go buy it and look at the components. Or check it out at the library at a con and play it and see if they match up to what you would want your game to look like.
Yeah. There's something for the saying of boots on the ground. I mean, those companies generally are the conduit for you to communicate to those manufacturers clearer. I don't have any personal examples with China, but in Brazil, Sao Paulo, getting product into Brazil, which is a freaking nightmare, it's one of those situations you kind of have to know a guy who knows a guy who knows a guy. And it took us a while to get the guy who knows a guy. So it's definitely worth it in some scenarios to use those guys, to use services like that, to ask those questions about color saturation. So they can be your voice, your boots on the ground in another country helping you do some business. But as James said, more often than not, you're probably gonna wind up paying a bit of a premium for them.
And I think with any of these, whether you're talking manufacturing or you're talking art design or whatever part of the process, at some level, you are purchasing knowledge, you're purchasing expertise in whatever it is. And that's a valuable commodity where you don't know it and you're not experienced. Yeah. And so I think it's worth it to invest in those things. Now you have to make your margins, you have to make it work at every level. But if you recognize that you are buying knowledge and you're buying something that you don't have or don't have the capability to easily obtain, then it's worth looking into for sure.
Yeah, it's tough to, because you're a new business, right? I think a lot of people enter the Kickstarter arena with a little bit of wrong mindset that they've made a game and they want to just put a game out to the other gamers. But you're actually making a business and you're presenting it to the world. And so
that's what you have to decide. Are you gonna make a game to make a game, or you right. making a game to, I no longer want to work at my job and I want to do games for a living. You need to decide that when you go to Kickstarter.
Yeah.
You just want to make a game to get it out of your head from blocking all the other things that you can't remember your anniversary because you got this game banging around. Get it out.
Sell it to a publisher.
Or say, yeah, exactly. Why would you do the hard work? Just sell it to a publisher. Or do you want to do this as a business like James is doing? James has quit his job and now he's going to be making games for a living, being a publisher. So that's a question, another question you have to ask before you go to Kickstarter. Where do you want to go with this?
And I partnered with Skybound Entertainment for Grim Forest for the retail side because that's the part of the business that I wasn't as experienced as they were, and they were going to be able to help me there. So even there's business opportunities to be made at every level of the process.
Yeah. Do you remember it this time?
This is kind of an etiquette question. If you are unsuccessful, like let's say you put the numbers too high at an expectation of getting a game made, and it doesn't go through on Kickstarter, how long do you wait to try again with maybe a lower expectation? Or is there, do you scour it?
Or whatever retooling you need to do.
Yeah,
it really depends on the retooling process. So if you just messed up your shipping and you need to get new quotes, you know, maybe a month. You could probably turn that around and get it back up pretty quickly. But if there was a lot of things that you got a lot of feedback on that needed a lot of different work and you needed to get new quotes, I mean, it really just depends on how quickly you can reassemble everything. There's probably no cookie cutter answer for that. But if there was only one major problem flaw and you didn't fund, then you can fix that one problem and get back up. I wouldn't like to do it the next week.
No.
People are going to think that you didn't really put any time and effort into fixing that problem.
Well, was it Lords of Zion was on Kickstarter a few months ago.
Yeah.
And they just recently came back with Stone something. I forget the name.
Stonebound Silence.
So like he did a bit of a whole re-theme overhaul. And it took him a few months to come back to it. So
this is his third launch, and Eric, I actually talked to him a whole lot. And he was someone who actually listened to all the feedback that he got and applied it. And then he came back and he didn't quite listen enough the second time, but he did much better. And then he failed again, but he came back the third time and he fully submitted to what people were saying and really rounded it out. It's already funded and hitting stretch goals now. And it's a gorgeous game, you should check it out. The Stonebound Saga, he didn't even say that.
No,
but it's a cool looking game. And I've actually played an early prototype, version, I guess 1.0, and it's enjoyable.
Trying to hit the same question or anything, but let's say, like you were saying, somebody's publishing, it's their first game, all right, and the major guys aren't going to pick it up because they only have one game to offer at the moment. Where do you go to next? Because if I have 5,000 games but can't get it to the market, you're saying go to a publisher?
You go to a publisher.
Yeah, you can co-publish it with another publisher, and they can pick it up and get it through their influence. There's also a guy named Aldo who does impressions.
Consolidators
can help there. They're going to be a better conduit for that, but they're also swamped. So he doesn't just take anything, but he at least will listen and take a look at your game because that's kind of how he makes
it. That's Aldo Gazzi with impressions. He works with all the distributors. He's actually one of my greatest tools to be able to pick up smaller publishers because I don't have to order case quantities from him. If I just want to try something out, I can just order four of something. Or if it's something I don't want to stock, but it's retailers who are asking for it, they can just special order it through us and I can get it from Aldo. Another consolidator is PSI, Public Services Incorporated. They're much larger. They handle publishing companies like Steve Jackson, Red Raven, Cryptozoic, Catalyst. Big companies usually handle it, but they're expanding quite a bit, PSI is, and they're adding a whole bunch of different people to their catalog as well. But those are the two main consolidators that pretty much every distributor works with. So those are who I would recommend if you don't want to sign with a publisher, you want to keep trying doing it on your own, that's another way to go.
And you're going to need to go pitch publishers. If you're not giving, you're going to need to go put it in front of people. So
the easiest part of
that scares you. I don't know what to tell you.
Yeah, the easiest part of selling and making a game is making the game after that. It's all just hard work and selling and grinding.
Yep.
It's fun, but it's
As a baseline to start, what business formation would you recommend, like LLC, S-Corp, the means to start building? And secondly, do you rely primarily on contract work, or do you try to bring people in-house over a period of time?
For sure, starting out, you want to bring in contract work. You don't want to tie yourself down to any sort of salaries or anything like that. Plus, you'll be able to find out if the people that you're reaching out to and working with are you work well with. You know, there's contractors that I've worked with one time, and there's contractors that I've worked with many times. And so, in not even necessarily say anything bad about the one-timers, it was just my vision, their vision, our styles, they didn't line up. So sometimes, and then sometimes you find people that just don't work at the pace that you work at. So as far as the corporation LLC, I'm not gonna comment on that at all because I did not wanna give you bad advice, and you're just gonna need to do your own research on that. But I can tell you that I formed my company under LLC, so that's what I did.
Yeah, LLC is pretty common, but pay attention to your state laws. There might be different states have different advantages for being one over the other. It's minor, but more often than not, you're gonna be an LLC. Athena, my wife in the back, is going to go around and she's going to hand out. I made a mock sell sheet for everybody. I'd like everybody to just kind of take a look at it, and if you have any questions about it, ask me. I think sell sheets are one of the most valuable tools to get your information quickly to retailers and distribution and end consumers. So pay attention to this and use them, please. They help.
Someone will.
Horse's mouth.
They will ask.
They are a necessity.
Still trying to form like this, I hope this makes sense. You go to a con, you go to like a first-timer's booth, you've got your game completely printed out through your own money, and it's selling all right, really, but you also have another game on Kickstarter. Let's say, does it help to already have a product and somebody seeing that it's already successful with something at a booth with a physical property have another thing in the pipeline that you're announcing on Kickstarter?
Absolutely. They can see that you can actually bring your idea to market and it turns into a thing. So yeah, sure, absolutely.
Something for the anthem.
It would hurt if it was crappy.
So the quality of the game.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Even if it's not their taste, but the components of quality and one of the big mistakes that I made on Barnyard Roundup, our first game, is I didn't do enough research on the fulfillment side, and I had a strategy. I can just talk.
Your voice is too magnificent. That's what it is.
I had a strategy to get European under VAT at a certain price with a certain weight, and so we went with a flimsy tug box. And it's the biggest regret I have about Barnyard. That thing needed to be in a nice two-piece box that was, you know, made me proud and made everybody else feel better about it. It's fine. The game
nothing
is bad about the game or the box, it still works just fine. But
so it's funny you say that about the tough box. I had this game sent to me. It was done, production done. It was a 680 card deck builder in a large, long tuck box where the length of lid opened up. The moment you took it out of the shrink wrap and you just like held it, the box folded and all the cards just flipped right out of it. So he had to go back to manufacturing and redo all of his boxes, because I told him there's absolutely no way I will buy a single copy this way. There's no way to store the product. Tough boxes are, unless you have Star Realms or smaller, it's not good, it's bad.
Yeah.
And when you're thinking about doing small products like that, this is one of the arguments, complaints people post on the internet. We'll look at Splendor or, you know, Gaia Monsters. These games can fit in a space, you know, this big. There's a reason the publishers put them in a large box. If they put a small thing on the shelf in a retailer store, it's going to get lost. It's not going to be seen on the shelf. Additionally, let's say somebody takes the game out that's next to it and puts this one back on the shelf. It's easy enough to just get pushed in the back, and then it's completely physically forgotten and not seen at all. So making sure when you design your box that it's got a good fronting shelf presence for a retailer. It's got a good shelf presence is what it's called.
Then we got time for one more question.
You have a question?
Chat has a question.
Oh, the chat has a question.
Yeah. Go ahead, what's Chad's question? We'll get you to it.
They're asking,
What time frame do you see as being the most successful to plan a great Kickstarter? In other words, how much time before you launch are you working to make it happen?
I'm going to let Daniel Zayas answer this question, because this is the perfect question.
I
what is the optimal time to launch a Kickstarter campaign?
Like, how long should you be planning?
Not calendar time, but they probably need both of that.
Yeah, both.
I would say at least a year planning. At least, I think you should be planning for a year.
Planning for a year, and then days lengthwise, how long do, what's the optimal campaign length on Kickstarter?
If you're a new creator, longer is better. 30 is the, Kickstarter recommends 30, they're right. They know better. If you are on your 10th campaign, 20 suffices, right? If you're on, even if you're very successful, you know, you can survive with less, right? Because you already have that market built in.
And then time frame of the year, I know that's a big question. Because a lot of people say, well, all the big boys are in the spring and summer, but then, you know, there's less competition in the fall and winter.
Right, so people are spending less money on Kickstarter, obviously, during Christmas, right? You can imagine that.
Yeah.
Gearing up towards April tax season, they're going to be spending more money. In the fall, there's all the big guys, and they're also, people are spending money at that point, early fall, I should say, but I mean, there's nowadays, like, even there's peaks in the summer, depending on, it used to be even a year ago, or you want to say 2 years ago, that creators were not launching campaigns as it directly related to big conventions. It's right. Not the case anymore. It really isn't. Folks are launching bigger campaigns in line with conventions so that they can be promoting it at that convention.
Yeah.
And lower those backers.
Yeah, when you look at that graph, it peaks in, say, April, May, as far as the top of users and money spent. So those are the two different categories, right?
Right.
Bulk volume of backers that are spending money on Kickstarter. And then it is a steady decline until it hits December. There's not a whole lot of blips in the map. It is from the peak straight down to December. So you got to put that into your planning as well.
Yep. Also be aware of what else is going on in the marketplace. Be aware when your Kickstarter is. The two most busiest times for Kickstarter, when it launches, when it ends. Pay attention what day your Kickstarter is going to end.
Yep.
If your Kickstarter is going to wind up ending in the middle of Gen Con, it's a bad idea. People are at the show, they're spending stuff at the show. Also, another thing you'd be considerate about, Magic pre-releases. Every publisher is getting to the habit where they're releasing product either on that same week or before or after the week, a brand new product on a pre-release weekend. So that's another time that people's cash flow is gonna be at its lightest. Gamers, your customer base are gonna be spending their money on boxes of Magic, brand new board games, packs of Yu-Gi-Oh, whatever. That's a big in consumer spending time, and that's every 2 months for the next, I think it's like 6 months, and then they're gonna go back to the 3 month model.
Yeah.
So pay attention to that. That is a big cash flow calendar.
To answer again, I've talked to Churn, and I'm gonna say his last name.
Churn
from Coleman. His direct answer is make something people want and it doesn't matter, right?
Kingdom death.
Right, make something be the best. You know, and you will win backers.
Yeah. In terms of marketing, when he did his Kickstarter, he did everything that you're not supposed to do and blew it out of the water with Kingdom Death.
Because it was the best. It was the best.
Yeah.
At the time, it was the best.
It's fantastic.
All right, what was your question again?
Yes. I was wondering, the retailer level on Kickstarter, does that contribute to the end goal? And many times I see it, it's like you have to go to another website if you're a retailer ordering it. I was just wondering.
You can model that in a lot of different ways. I think companies are still really trying to figure out the best way to do that, because retailers, to what Mike was telling you earlier, they don't want to put out money a year in advance on a product that they can't sell right now, right? So it's very difficult for them to back at full price. Well, actually, most of them won't back at a full price because they need their margins to be able to resell it and make money to keep the lights on. And so on your end, you're going to have to offer them some sort of discount in that pledge for multiple copies, right? And so there's a lot of different ways to pull that off.
typically you're going to want to probably have a side piece, because end consumers get upset when they find out that other people can buy a game at a discount that they don't get offered, but they're not reselling it. So
I had this is just a mindset, the lack of education for most end consumers on the cost of goods. I used to have a store, and I had this one guy come in. We were next to this sports bar, and he wanted to come in and buy every single pack of Yu-Gi-Oh! I had on the shelf for 50 cents each. And I'm like, no, there's no way I would do that. He's like, but you're going to make a sale. I'm like, yeah, but I paid like $1.50 for each one of these. Why would I do that? He's like, well, you're going to make the sale. They don't understand the cost of the goods. They don't understand the value of the goods. So the end consumers, when you tell them, if they ever find out how much, you know, retailers are paying for product, they lose their minds. They don't understand the concept that retailers pay a different price. They think they're paying $50 for a $50 game, and all of a sudden magic happens in their bank account and they've made a profit.
But how much does a reseller or typical retail store spend with you in a month to be able to have that discount?
Like have a discount?
We
don't have tiered pricing.
But what do they spend? $10,000 a month? $20,000 a month?
It can fluctuate. Sure. It can fluctuate a lot.
So they're spending.
There's all kinds of different sizes
of
accounts. Yeah, they can spend a lot of money. But
so that's why they get a discount, right?
Yeah.
So we didn't really answer the question. It's really hard.
Yeah.
You can probably pull me off the side at some point and I'll give you some more pointers.
That part of Kickstarter is in a bit of a fluctuation on what we can and can't do.
Because there's some rules within Kickstarter too about they want the money to flow through them, and so if you're doing something outside of Kickstarter, they don't like that. Which, to their credit,
it's their business.
That's their business
model.
So
can't fault them.
Yeah. All right. So that's about all the time we have for. I do want to leave you with one thing, like encourage you that you guys are forming a business if you're going to go to Kickstarter. So take it seriously. Like every piece of what you're doing is putting yourself out there for people to judge you and whether or not they want to give you their hard-earned money.
Yeah.
You have cool ideas. I have no doubt in my mind that people in this room can be successful board game publishers, but you got to put in the hard work. It's a bajillion hours. You're not just going to be able to make this a little small side hustle. You're going to have to work really, really hard. I was working 120 hours a week because I had my main job and then this. And
now you're only working like what, 180?
No, now I work like 10 hours. It's easy. I just print games and make money. That's how it works. No, but seriously, you have great ideas and you have something to offer the world. Go out there and do it, but be serious about it. Don't just lollygag about it. You've got to go make contacts and work hard and make contacts in areas that you are not strong at and then pay those people.
Yeah.
Like it's a risk. It is a big risk on your part. I had elbow, neck, ears, eyes deep in debt to bring Grim Forest to the market the way it needed to be brought to market. You can't patchwork that thing together with some band-aids and some duct tape. So you guys can do it. Go do the thing.
That's it.
That's all I got.